And we turn now to the vulnerability of the internet after a week of very visible hacks and attacks.
In the days following the release of classified government documents by WikiLeaks, thousands of the site's supporters, so-called hacktivists, have launched online attacks aimed at companies and groups they deem hostile to WikiLeaks and to the free flow of information. Last week, a group calling itself Anonymous targeted the websites of Visa, MasterCard, and PayPal, among others, after the companies stopped processing donations to WikiLeaks. Government websites, too, have been vulnerable. The Senate website was slowed last week after Senator Joe Lieberman criticized sites enabling WikiLeaks. The attacks use software that chain together hundreds of computers that all request information from the same website at the same time, causing a traffic jam that makes the site inaccessible.
This is a little bit more like what happened in the 60s when protesters took over buildings at universities where people couldn't get in the building, but it's not really them blowing up the building.
While all that goes on, this weekend there was another example of online hacking, this one affecting the popular site Gawker, an 8-year-old digital media company that hosts blogs on media, technology, and pop culture. A group calling itself Gnosis raided Gawker, borrowing inside its databases to unlock the usernames, passwords, and email addresses of some 1.3 million people who'd left comments on the site. Gawker was forced to stop publishing temporarily Sunday and urged its users to change their passwords. There were signs the hackers had acted in retaliation after a war of words with Gawker. They also appeared to send a message about the vulnerability of usernames and passwords, listing several thousand accounts in which the password for the account is the word password.
Our own Hari Sreenivasan covers technology developments for us online has been following the Gawker situation. He joins me now for an update. So, Hari, first, for those who don't know much about Gawker, tell us a little bit more. What is it?
Well, it is one of the largest publishers on the web, and it's really an amazing set of sites. Whether you care about cars or you care about gadgets, it's one of the must-check sites on the internet. And it's almost like a modern-day salon because people come there for information, but they're coming just as much for the comment threads and to leave a comment, really to be part of a conversation.
All right, so we talk about this group called Gnosis. How much do we know about who they are and what did they do to Gawker?
A lot of these sort of hacker groups are very shadowy in nature in the sense that there's no card-carrying membership that says, I'm part of this club, I'm the one who did this, and here's my address and phone number. So really what they did to Gawker was come in behind the scenes in the past few weeks, past few months, figure out vulnerabilities, and essentially start to take the keys to the kingdom. Everything that Gawker held dear, most important, the user information, they took all of that out and splayed it out across the internet. They didn't hide the information for themselves for some sort of kind of nefarious means. They said, here, take it, because this is really, they're the crown jewels for
and
a website.
And you were telling me earlier today that you went online last night.
Yeah.
And so give us examples. What could you see there?
Well, something very minimally invasive was that I could see what the future of the Gawker website was supposed to look like, which is something pretty important that you want to try to keep secret. If I was a real kind of a technologist, I could actually see the content management system. I could see the databases. I could see where they store their passwords. I could see the advertising information, which could be very important. But the most important, again, the crown jewels were the usernames, the passwords, and the email addresses connected to them of some 1.3 million users. That's really the stuff that I, as a complete novice, could see.
Now, how are those people affected? In what ways?
Well, so the thing, it kind of gets back to a little bit of social engineering. So a lot of times people don't make separate passwords and separate usernames for different websites. Sometimes they use the same website or same email address that I have for work onto a site like Gawker, and then maybe that's the same password that gets me into Facebook, and then it's also connected to Twitter. So as we see all of these different kind of communities that we participate in during the day, people aren't very good at keeping these walls separate. So that's where the real influence is.
And I heard today that they use that to affect Twitter as well, right?
That's right. So
this would be people who use the same password for Gawker and Twitter.
That's right, the same username or the password. So basically somebody between last night and this morning wrote a small computer program that figured out that little exploit. And so while hundreds or maybe thousands of people are asleep, their Twitter accounts were automatically sending out advertisements for the acai berry or acai berry, however you said, the super berry, right? So while you were sleeping, you were actually a victim to somebody else's marketing scam.
Now, what if our viewers don't go on Gawker? Should they care?
Well, they should care because this actually exploits larger vulnerabilities into their workplaces. Not only were there Gmail and Yahoo accounts, there were a lot of government accounts. There were a lot of EDU, which means universities or educational institution accounts. So if these people don't change their passwords, don't get a little stronger about their own protections, those systems could also be compromised. I mean, all of those email addresses are now out there for other hackers to exploit.
And what of Gawker? I mean, I said they temporarily stopped publishing. They're certainly back now. But have they taken any steps that we know of to prevent this in the future?
Well, they said that they are. They apologized to their users profusely on their blog. They said, we're really embarrassed and really we want to try to help you. Go ahead and change that password. But ironically enough, this morning, if I wanted to delete my account on Gawker, I couldn't do that because the database that would have allowed me to do that was corrupted by the hackers last night.
All right. Hari Sreenivasan, thanks a lot.